This week, three sides of the coin. We try and define what is a classic Kiss song. Mark has his definition. Tommy and I have
and I
our
have
definition.
This is Three Sides of the Coin, talking all things Kiss.
I want to rock and roll all night.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
So you love the show. Go to itunes.threesidesofthecoin.com and leave your review and rating of Three Sides of the Coin. Thanks.
Everybody, welcome back to another episode of Three Sides of the Coin. I am one of your three co-hosts, Michael Branvold. And as always, I'm joined by Tommy Summers, Mark Cicchini. How you two Weisenheimers doing?
Doing well.
I'm good.
So we're flying by the seat of our pants. We had a quick change in discussion for today. Our special guest is being bumped back. Not canceled, just bumped back. So I think what we're going to do, we had getting some pretty good response to our version of Fuck, Marry, Kill that we did last week with Brent Muscat, which was a lot of fun. And because you two knuckleheads wanted something with Crazy Nights in it,
yeah, because this is something we get to get rid of.
So
response to one.
So I came up with a couple more rounds of what we call Krank, Kill, Redo, and obviously love it if you guys play along with us and share your answers to this. So here's the first one: Krank, Kill, Redo. Peter Criss solo album. Carnival of Souls, Crazy Nights.
Ooh, that's good, Mike. Do you want me to go first?
Sure, go for it. Looks like you're thinking hard.
Carnival of Souls, because I dig that record. Hate is in my top 10 favorite all-time Kiss tunes. I call them, it's funny, I don't know if you guys do this or any of the fans out there do this. Are there any songs from the non-makeup era that are makeup songs to you? Meaning, the first time I heard Unholy, I'm like, that's a makeup thing. Another great example is Not for the Innocent. To me, I'm like, that would have fit so well on Creatures. That's like a makeup tune. And I think Hate's a makeup tune, meaning that I can see the demon persona really getting into that song. So anyways, I'd crank that one. I actually like that record a lot. Redo Peter Criss's record with I'd like to hear that with like Kiss playing on. I mean, look, Hooked on Rock and there's
yeah, but that's not going to happen. The solo album, it's a solo album. Kiss, the other band members are not going to play on it.
Look, my rules here.
Already, Tommy. Already.
First one out of the gate. Jesus.
We're redoing it, right? So I'm redoing it with the four original members.
How about redoing it like with Led Zeppelin playing it instead? I mean, Jesus, if you're going to totally change the rules.
And by the way, it's pretty easy to tell you which one we do. Bye-bye.
All right, Tommy, what would you do?
I would keep Peter's. I would get rid of Kill, Carnival of Souls, and I would redo Crazy Nights. That was easy.
Okay. I would obviously crank Crazy Nights. I would kill Peter Criss.
Literally?
And I'd redo Carnival of Souls and just redo it so it's a Kiss album, not a Bruce Kulick solo album with Kiss playing on it.
And you'd have to take the song Hate off just to bug Mark.
There you go. All right. All right, so here's a twist on this whole concept. So Krank, Kill, Redo. The lineup of Gene, Paul, Ace, and Peter. The lineup of Gene, Paul, Ace, and Eric. The lineup of Gene, Paul, Eric, and Vinny.
Oh, don't do that.
Well, don't change the rules. Don't change the rules.
Okay. Keep Jean, Paul, Ace, and Peter. Kill the version with Vinny. That's a no-brainer. And then the redo part, I don't know what we would redo. You know, so I mean, if I have to pick the current lineup for the redo, there's nothing I would change. That's the hard part with that one. So, costumes?
No, no, oh, no, I'm talking Gene, Paul, Ace, Eric as an Eric Carr.
Okay.
So basically, yeah, the first three incarnations of Kiss in makeup.
Oh, gotcha. Okay, I'm sorry, I misunderstood. Yeah, I wouldn't change it. You know, it would still be Gene, Paul, Ace, and Eric for the redo. And I guess if I had to, I'd pick a different drummer, even though I really liked Eric Carr, if I had to play by your rules to change it.
And I'll give you guys leeway in what redo means to you, whether it's redoing the lineup with different people or having that lineup redo the music that they created.
That's where I was going.
That's what I would say that. I would, like we talked about last week, I would metal up the Unmasked record.
Mark?
You know, that's what I would do.
To me, Krank the original version. Come on. It's a no-brainer. So the original version would be Krank. Redo the incarnation, the second incarnation. I'd like to see them with Unmasked. I'd like to see it exactly as Tommy said. Have them not do the Elder. Have them start work on the rockin' songs that they eventually did. Have Ace on Preachers. You know what I mean? Have that sort of redo.
Yes.
And I'm not even going to answer the third question because the Vinny era rules, but that, for this dumb game.
And if I okay, so work within the confines of your rules, and here he goes again. God.
All right, so I'm not going to comment on this part.
Why don't we just do something like this? Let's pick three things, and you have to say that all of them are awesome.
I love the A Vinny era, but for this silly contest, I'm going to let it go down in flames. You guys happy now?
No. You're still cheating.
So yes, Krank the originals, redo the stuff from 80 to 82, and want the third. So.
Yeah, I would agree. The original four have to be Kranked. You got to keep that. I would kill the version with Vinny, even though you know the Creatures of the Night, Lick It Up. Albums are incredibly strong, but I would much rather see Gene, Paul, Ace, and Eric Carr actually record and redo and make rock albums instead of being lost in the albums that they did do. The two albums, and, you know, and I basically
still be with Dan Hartman.
Who cares where Vinny's with? It's just I think we've never gotten. You know, we didn't get a great, great, solid Kiss rock album out of Ace Frehley, Eric Carr lineup, and I think that would have been great to go back.
Maybe,
you know, just we've always said redo Unmasked as a hard rock album, not as a pop album.
Maybe he becomes a construction worker in the Village People.
Maybe he becomes one of our bullpen.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, you know, next week I may have to. It depends. I'm going to be cutting it close. I'm leaving for Florida on Thursday, like the day, not tomorrow, the next day, and I'm coming back next Tuesday. But I think my plane arrives at like 2:45, so I should be back.
So should we have the bullpen ready to go though?
Well, it depends if our guest. If our guest is next week, I'm going to make sure that I'm excited. You know. Cause that's a person I really want to talk to.
And you,
so,
and
but
you
I guess
them.
we could give these.
Yeah. Are you going to a swingers convention or what?
Stop.
All
but
right.
Anyway, it depends because I think last we left it, he just had to reschedule. We're not sure if it's next week.
Yep. So here's
I'm talking about this. right now.
Here's one more Krank Kill redo. Psycho Circus Sonic Boom Monster.
Oh, that's easy. You Krank Sonic Boom. You redo Monster. I'd like to get the mix better and Shit Can Son or Psycho Circus, although the title track's one of my favorites too, but that's where we go with that.
Tommy.
I would agree with Mark wholeheartedly. Same thing. But I want to stop and ask you a question from a music standpoint, because you're in a band, you've recorded albums. What's wrong with Monster? Because I feel like when I listen to it, it sounds muddy. I don't know what other word.
Some people call it brick ball. There's a couple different terms for it. It's too hot. You can't get much volume out of it. I just don't like the way it was mastered. Mastering is like incredible. It's funny. I just don't think they spend enough time on the mastering. I think it's too hot overall. You can't get much volume out of it. It distorts quickly.
Yes.
I'll give you a great example. I know you're not a big Judas Priest fan, but I'm going to give you two songs that I know you probably like, Tommy. Do you like Living After Midnight?
Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah, okay.
I've heard it so many times.
Yeah, but you're familiar then with you got another thing coming.
Yep.
Because to me, Screaming for Vengeance, which is what You Got Another Thing Coming's on, that's another record to me. You can't get much volume out of it. It just distorts. And it's just using that because, you know, they're the same band and they're metal, you know. But listen how you can crank the other one just a lot. The guitars aren't as distorted. It's more organic to me. And I think those are two popular songs that I think most people in this audience will understand. And if you want to go to Spotify or whatever, A/B those. You can really – the production to me is better – almost less is more with this kind of music. And that's a great example to me. And Monster is the same way. Monster, it just doesn't, like I said, I don't think the production is all that great. Although I love the record.
The songs are phenomenal. But maybe that's what it is. It's just muddy's the only word I can come up with, because it kind of sounds swoosh, like,
Especially if you want to get some volume on it. It's not one of those records you can crank because of the sonics aren't that great. Whereas I think Sonic Boom, sonically, is a lot better of a listen.
Yeah, so, I would agree.
I would crank Psycho Circus. I would redo Monster, mainly because the song Right Here, Right Now, in my opinion, was one of the best Kiss songs recorded in decades. I mean, it showed real, to my ears, that was Kiss. That one song started to sound exactly like what I wanted Kiss to sound like. Redo Monster.
Dare I say...
What?
Dare I say classic?
Kiss? Could be. When we'll talk about that in a few moments. And... I would kill Sonic Boom as by default. I think Monster has a better chance of being a even greater album if it's redone than Sonic Boom would if it was redone.
Interesting.
Well, Sonic Boom just sounds so good now. I mean, to me, that really was the perfect, if you want to call it, comeback record. It's so even keel. And again, this is a subject we're going to talk in depth about here in the next minutes, I'm guessing. But yeah, that record had a very familiar sound, a sound I hadn't heard in a long time, and I was very happy with sonically. Whereas Monster didn't. Monster,
I think
it's funny because my Right Here, Right Now is hard to crank too. That one distorts too. There's just
I think the songwriting to me felt better on Monster than it did on Sonic Boom. Sonic Boom, you know, everybody says it harkens back to 70s era Kiss, but to me it harkens back to 80s era Paul Stanley. And it just, Sonic Boom felt a little bit on the cheesy side to me, where Monster felt like it was less cheese.
Well, the subject here? Or,
well,
we're
so,
going there.
Yeah, so let's segue into.
Hold on, want to do the letter?
Oh,
here
yeah,
first?
Yeah, Tommy, you've got a comment you want to share?
Yeah, just to set this up, one of the things that I talked to my wife about a lot is just what an incredible experience that this has been. Doing this podcast and just how wonderful.
I thought you were going to say you really want to hook up and swing with Mark and Liz.
No, I didn't say that.
Thank God.
Yeah, I don't want to end up being the meat in the sandwich. You know. let's just leave it at that and
okay,
go no further.
Yeah.
But so. So just that, you know, we're the three of us knuckleheads are so incredibly blessed. And it's funny because I'll post these pictures with these different musicians and stuff. And people are like, oh, is this happening? It's like, I don't know. Cool shit just keeps happening. But out of all of that cool stuff, the coolest stuff to me is letters like this. And we get a bunch of these. And this goes beyond just, hey, found your website or your show and I used to be a fan and I'm not anymore and now I am again and all that. That's fantastic. But I want to read this to you, okay? The intro is, hello, you three crazy amigos and sometimes four. I just wanted to drop you a quick note saying I really just discovered your forum a few months ago and find myself at 5 a.m. in the morning listening to all of you and reliving my Kiss years. I first saw Kiss in 1977 on the Love Gone tour at San Diego Sports Arena, and I was 15 years old and absolutely stunned at what I saw. I was the biggest Kiss fan of all my friends and just couldn't get enough Kiss. As a guitar player since the age of 6, I was a huge fan, Ace fan, and I still am. I just watched your show with Jason Hook and was mesmerized as to how all you relive your Kiss years and enjoy them just as much now as when you were young. I found myself feeling the same way as I sat for 2 hours straight in the wee hours of the morning so not to disturb the wife. Funny story, my parents came to see my new home and visit me in Boise, Idaho. My dad is 83 and my mom is 80. The day they got here and I had to leave them alone because Kiss was opening the tour here and I wasn't going to miss that show for the world, so there you go. It was a great show as always and it prompted a conversation from my mother about the time she came home, I was 10, and she saw flames shooting above the fence. When she came into the backyard, she saw me and my other friend with a bottle of her hairspray and a lit newspaper doing the best fire-breathing impression. Not a good day for Steve Esther. After that, I got in trouble for mixing up some red blood with food coloring and spitting it all over my friend's front porch and deck. Needless to say, it did not come off. Thank you guys so much what you do, and I feel like I may have found the friends I've been looking for my whole life, crazy Kiss friends. Take care, guys, and please take care, you guys, and please keep going. Some of us need you to, Steve. And I don't know. I mean, I just – what a nice letter, and when you guys reach out like that, it's just – it makes me feel good that we are providing some entertainment to people, even just for a couple of hours a week. And that will never get lost on the three of us. And we really appreciate it. And so we all agreed that we had to, you know, we needed to read that. So, Steve, thanks for sending it in.
Yeah. You know, I just want to add to what Tommy said. Yeah, I completely agree. But it's just so cool that we're helping people sort of rediscover their youth, their memories, the great times as a kid that, you know, as we all get older and life gets busy and complicated and everything else, a lot of times you forget those good moments, those fun little moments of when you were a kid. And it is just so cool that we keep hearing from fans. It's like, yeah, you brought back that memory when I was 10 or 12 or 15 or my first show or my first album or the first t-shirt I got or whatever it is. Because, you know, we're not in purposely setting out to do anything other than just talk about our own memories. And you guys discovering your memories because of that is just really cool.
Uh-huh. Well said.
That's exactly it. You know, it's funny, too, on a personal note. I've been so lucky to you know, participate in things and get my name in CD booklets and books and magazines and stuff. And I thought about this really, really cool quote that Neil Peart once said, and he's like, I didn't set out to be, you know, I just set out to be great. Everything else found me. And that's kind of what this is, doing this, being able to talk to fans and stuff and being able to do stuff for the band. And I just liked being a Kiss fan, and I liked collecting Kiss, and I liked learning about them, and I enjoyed their music, and I loved talking to other fans, you know. And 30, 40 years later, here I am, you know, talking to people every week about it. And it's, I know exactly what you're feeling, Tommy. And then when someone says something like that, like, you got me through the day, or your podcast means so much, and it's bringing back so many great memories. Wow. You know, and more so than anything, Michael, you grew up a Kiss fan and then you worked for them. I mean, that wasn't the goal. You're just a big fan, and just, your fandom.
Yeah, it just happens.
Cool shit keeps happening. That's our motto from this point forward, I think. And for me, it really makes me feel good that I know that I made someone else feel happy, even if it's for just an hour or two, and that we can add something to your lives and that we can be a part of your lives. That doesn't go that doesn't get lost on us at all. And I am appreciative every single day for the opportunity to do this. And also, too, I think it makes things better for me as a person to relive some of that stuff, because you guys will say something and it'll trigger a memory of me hanging out in the backyard doing something like what Steve was saying with the hairspray. And then you start thinking about, you know, my friend Ward or something like that, and go, God, you know, we did some really fun shit together. And then you think about other stuff. And it's so funny because here we are, like you said, 30, 40 years later, and now I finally feel like we can have a discussion about all this and I don't have to feel uncomfortable. Whereas it seemed like when you're growing up, when you weren't around your immediate friends that understood it, you were constantly doing battle with other people who didn't get it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Cool. Yeah, so keep sending us your comments. I mean, you can send them through our website, 3sidesofthecoin.com, Facebook page, YouTube, wherever we've got the show, you can leave a comment or send us a message, because we may not respond to all of them, and don't take that personally, but we do read them all. I mean, and we do get hundreds and thousands of messages, but we do read them.
It's true.
All right, so a segue from what we were just talking about previously, there was a recent interview with Paul Stanley, and I didn't copy what the source was, but he was probably one of the local town newspapers, because he was promoting one of the shows on the current tour. And the gist of it, this is, I would say, is what makes a classic Kiss song? And I'm going to read you Paul Stanley's quote, and then we can discuss. So here's what Paul Stanley said. A song can only become classic as it gains age, he reflects. Fine wine has to age. What makes a song classic is that it endures. You have a time period or an event that's associated with it. That doesn't happen overnight. Psycho Circus has become a classic. Lick It Up has become a classic. Do I think Hell or Hallelujah will? Absolutely. So that's his comment. Let's discuss and why this sort of, I wanted to bring this up as a potential topic for us is, Tommy, you remember when we were in Vegas and Paul goes, and I don't know what, how he entered it exactly, but I'm paraphrasing. And this next song is a classic Kiss tune, Hell or Hallelujah. And we didn't say anything. We just kind of looked at each other, because we immediately got it. It's like, classic Kiss song, yeah. Hell or Hallelujah. It may be a good song, but it's not a classic song yet, just because Paul Stanley says it's classic. So I figured, based on that, we could have a little discussion here as to what do we each feel. It's not so much what are the classic Kiss tunes, because that discussion can be a rabbit hole, like a set list discussion. I guess I'm more interested in what does it take to make a song a classic song? Does that make sense?
Yeah, but I think, at least in my mind, as I was thinking about this up to the show today, in some situations, one goes hand in hand with the other. You know, because it's hard for me to keep my bias out of it as well, because some could argue that I Love It Loud is a classic Kiss song. I'm like, and by the way, screw you, Marty. You kept playing that on repeat the whole day at the Heavy Metal Grill. We must have heard that thing 4 times. I'm like, God, he's torturing me.
I know. Yeah, I get what you're saying, but I guess all I want to qualify the rules, Mark, the one rule is you can't sit here and go, The Oath, that's a classic Kiss tune, because Oath is such a favorite song of yours. I mean, that's not what I don't think that's what discussion is not about, is what do you want to be a classic Kiss tune? What don't you, you know, I don't want to hear Rock and Roll All Night should not be a classic Kiss tune. It's more of what does it take to make a song classic?
Well, I would say the first answer I would give would be it has to have radio airplay and a familiarity with a lot of different people. Not everybody, but, you know, if you're looking at their current set list, the majority of them I would consider to be Kiss classics or classic songs, simply because of the fact that the majority of the folks who are coming to the shows, not all, but the majority, will recognize Love Gun, Detroit Rock City, Rock and Roll All Night, Beth. So I think that there has to be a familiarity with it that goes beyond the band's initial fandom. You know, because you could say the same thing about the Eagles, okay? I would give you 10 to 12 songs that are the Eagles that I would consider to be classic songs. Are they the best songs? Perhaps, perhaps not. But it would be all the ones that everyone would know. And so I would say the same thing about Fleetwood Mac as well, to use another example, or Aerosmith. Pick anyone you want. So I think that if Hell or Hallelujah doesn't get enough radio airplay and enough familiarity with people, especially now that MTV isn't playing music anymore, I find it very hard to believe that any Kiss song will become a classic moving forward any more than any other band. The only person I would say could still create a classic song would be someone like AC/DC, where their songs, when they have a new record that comes out up until the last one, typically get pushed so hard on FM rock stations that they end up getting exposed enough to the masses that there's a familiarity with them.
Are you finished?
Yeah.
I look at it a totally different prism than you do. Because Kiss isn't a radio band, and Motorhead's not a radio band. And I could, you know, and there's a ton of bands I could go down the list where I think there's classic music there.
Here comes The Oath.
No.
No, I'm sorry.
Well, to me, I look at a couple different things. Classic Kiss, to me, is the first 6 records. And you have to throw Dynasty in because of I Was Made for Loving You was such a big hit. So I would say that songs afterward and that could fit on that template. Whereas Hell or Hallelujah, and I think this is where Paul's coming, if you could somehow time travel and bring that song to the Love Gun sessions, that song would fit on that classic Kiss album. It would fit all day long. Hell or Hallelujah would fit on Love Gun. Now, if you want to dissect the Kiss catalog a little further, and this is one of the problems that I have with the 80s overall, King of the Mountain, or even or Exciter, wouldn't fit on the first 6 records, not even close. It was a totally different band. Now, here's where I'm going to jump a little bit. And again, no matter how you talk about these things, there's always a bit of hypocrisy. I don't think that honey, how would you put this?
Like, did you just call us honey? Did you just call us honey?
Not say that. I don't. I love the term of endearment. Is a classic Kiss song to me.
You know, honey past lube.
I absolutely love that, and I don't understand how, but that wouldn't fit on the first six records. But I like Preacher. You know what I mean? That. So now we want to go back to the Oath. The Oath would have fit perfectly, I think, on Preachers. Although if they would have, it would, I don't think they would have been able to sing it the way they did musically. It's there.
Well, I get where you're coming from, but at the same time, I don't know if I can roll down that road with you, because then let's talk about the Rolling Stones, because there will be a lot of people who would argue with you that Start Me Up is a classic Rolling Stones song, and that's definitely a different band than the stuff in the 60s off of their first decade of records, you know? And so it's kind of like, I don't know if the lineup has anything to do with it, because Lick It Up would consider to be a classic as well. And that's well, not the original band.
Your analogy, though, of the Stones, just we're being music snobs here. That song's from the early 70s.
It doesn't matter. I understand that.
My point is that was written during those classic, you know, Exile on Main Street, Sticky Fingers.
But then look at Tom Kiefer.
Tom Kiefer's a great example, too. The stuff from his solo record certainly would have fit, especially more so on Long Cold Winter? Yeah, because I think that there's a big difference between those first two records. I think they were more comfortable in their skin on the second one. The first one, I love Cinderella. Those first two records are dynamite.
No, you know,
but as we went, you know what I mean? I think his jeans and t-shirt rock and roll really, you know, kind of took over. They weren't trying to be something they weren't on, especially image wise and even sound wise. They were more of a hard rock band as they, you know,
I'm getting lost in this, though. My point I was going to make is that I don't necessarily agree with you that it has to fit onto the first couple records or this or that to be a classic song. Either it's a good song that people relate to and have familiarity with it, or it's not. So, I mean, the same argument could probably be made that Motorhead has no classic songs in the respect that a lot of people don't even know who Motorhead is, not right or wrong. But talking in generalizations of what a classic song is, I would think that it has to also fall into that whole idea that more than just that, you know, telescope of people who love the band are aware.
I sort of hear two different discussions going on here, though. You know, Tommy's talking about parts of what it takes to become a classic song. Mark, I'm hearing you talk about a big what-if scenario. How would The Oath become a classic song? Well, if you moved it over to here and it was in this lineup, then it would be. But
a classic song for Kiss fans. It is a classic song. There's no doubt about it.
But
because that's what people. Hold on a second. Give me one more second here, and then I'll let you go. Most classic songs I've never heard on the radio. I love like catalog songs. That's what made me a fan of bands, was not the songs I heard on the radio. Most of it was the catalog.
But I wasn't just bought
the one song. I bought the whole record, and I wanted to enjoy the whole record. And there's certain eras that made it classic. Last week we talked, since you guys went to the 80s. The first few Rat albums to me are classic Rat-sounding records.
So
they got farther down, I don't think they stayed with that same
Start with not what makes a classic song. How do you define a classic song? What is your definition of a classic song?
You want to see it? I'll show it to you. I'll show it to you.
Oh, Lord, what are you going to show us?
As soon as I hear it, I'm like,
cool.
Yes, that's a classic song. It defies words. When you hear it, and you're driving, you got whatever Sirius XM on, and they're just rattling through on Ozzy's Boneyard. And to me, And this is a great example. Like when Riot's Swords and Tequila comes on, because I love, there's a song you never heard on the radio.
Is that, a metaphor for something?
Fucking love. All of a sudden it comes on that because other metalheads like me dug it, or the song Metal Church from Metal Church will come on that radio station. And I'll go like, hell yeah. Because the reason that those bands who never got huge have a fan base is because people like me found their music. And when they do play, like I said, if you ever listen to Ozzy's Boneyard, a lot of times they'll play, like I said, Riot or Metal Church, or band that didn't get freaking huge. But if you were a fan of that band and you heard that, you went, it was funny too, because the other day I heard Rock and Roll Machine by Triumph on there, and I was just driving. I'm like, fuck yeah. Again, was that their big hit? No, Lay It on the Line and, Fight the Good Fight, which are. But Rock and Roll Machine was one of those catalog tunes, and you had the record, and you were a fan because you bought their stuff. Again, that to me is classic. It has nothing to do with it hearing on the radio. To me, that means absolutely nothing. What matters to me is it hits me here, and that's how come it's a visual.
So I mean, and this is all I'm saying is, I see what Mark is saying as, that's just a personal favorite great tune. And there's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, I would use a different word than classic then.
Exactly, because there's a lot of tunes by Kiss and any artist where I'm like, oh, yeah, it's a headbang tune. It's not a classic tune. It's not a tune that has... It's a great favorite best of tune. But in my mind, to me, what I define a classic tune as is... A song that goes above and beyond just the fan base of that artist. That a song that can live on its own
transcends the band.
It transcends the band. And to Tommy's original point, I think one of the things that needs to happen for that to occur is the song has to get played. It either has to get a lot of radio airplay or it has to get a lot of in-concert airplay. If that song, no matter how great it is and how much you do this, never gets radio airplay or the band themselves don't even play it in concert, it's never going to become an elevated song of the classic level. And in the case of Hell or Hallelujah, Kiss themselves don't even play it in concert on any sort of regular basis. I mean, you could argue that Hide Your Heart is a lot more of a classic tune than Hell or Hallelujah, or Crazy Nights is a lot more of a classic tune than Hell or Hallelujah, because the band plays that tune a lot more, and in the case of both of them, they got significantly more airplay, more video airplay. They moved above and beyond the rest of the catalog. Are they the best songs on those albums? No. But I'm not saying a classic song is the best song.
Well, that's why we have to change the name, because I totally understand where you're coming from, Mark. But my thought when I heard what Michael was saying to my point earlier is that classic meant something different to me than it does to you. And the validity of your point is there, but it's different because I'm looking at it just from an acceptable level from people who don't really know the band very well. So case in point, if you want to ask me what song is the essence of classic, I would say Hotel California. Because everyone knows it everywhere. And it doesn't mean that it's good or better than a Deep Purple song or a Kiss song or whatever, but that to me is the epitome of a classic. You could probably do that with 36 Rolling Stones songs and 36 Beatles songs. Those two probably have more than anyone else. Elton John, whomever.
So Kiss could really technically only have 3 classic songs if you want to just bring the masses in.
You're right. I was just going to say that. You could argue that in Kiss's world, it's Rock and Roll All Night, Beth, Detroit
Shout
Rock
It Out
City,
Loud,
Shout It Out
Forever.
Loud. Forever.
Forever. Forever. Know it.
But
Lick It Up.
Here's where I go back to our guest when Martin was on. And hear me out here. There's a reason out of all the Riot catalog that Ozzy's Boneyard would play Swords in the Gale. Because it was their most popular song. Was it a big hit? No, but fans who love that genre know that song. There's a reason that gets played. Because it's funny. Mike, you worked with Accept, right?
Yeah.
Okay. You're familiar with Fast as a Shark?
Yeah.
Balls to the Wall buries it as far as recognition.
In my context, I would argue that Balls to the Walls is Accept's classic song. There's a lot of other incredible songs that blow it away, but when it comes to what is a classic Accept song, Balls to the Walls is going to be it.
I'm not arguing that it's not it, but to me, because I'm a catalog guy with that band, Breaker and all that other stuff, Restless and Wild, I mean, that's on par with that. I mean, I get the same when it comes on, and to me, that's what defines classic. Now, what I think Tommy was defining, and of course, Tommy, this is all speculative, but yeah, Hotel
this California. This is where he insults me, but he's nice about it.
But I think Hotel California is just, look, I think everybody knows the song. I love the song. I'm a big Eagles fan. They're great. I'm the entire catalog. I love it. It's funny. That's a band as I got older, I liked more. It's funny. When I was a kid, I had the one with the Eagles head or whatever. I had the greatest hits. I'm like, eh, it's cool. But as I got older, I'm like, wow, there's so much more here, you know, especially the early stuff. But right around the long run, I didn't like that stuff so much. But I love music so much that I can't look at things because to me, what radio plays, it's kind of like what we talked about with our guests, Payola and all that other shit. That's what made it some of that stuff. To me, the best songs of a band aren't the ones that got on the radio.
I would agree with that.
I totally agree, Mark. And I think the big difference that between your point of view and mine is, your point of view is you're sticking to you as the fan. You're speaking as yourself and what you love. And I'm trying to step out of that and just go from a very generalized state.
I use the Riot as an example, though, Mike.
Well, can I bring
because
up...
Because they have big, multi-selling records, but that's Riot the one song that they will play on the radio station.
Listen, no insulting to you or Riot, but Riot is not a band to say a classic anything. I mean, most people are going to go, Riot as in quiet?
Yep.
Well, it's too bad they didn't take the time to hear it.
I know of the band Riot. I could not tell you one single song of the band Riot. I know they were a hard rock, I'm assuming a hard rock band. Maybe they were a metal band. I don't know. And see that
down
that,
below, Narita, get those records, man. They're great.
No idea what you're talking about, other than I've heard of the band. And you're coming from the passion of a fan who loves that, and that's cool. And all I'm saying is, for this discussion, I'm removing that and trying to just sit here and go, okay, in the general, I'm a casual music fan, what is a classic tune? Because if we wanted to put passion into it, I would sit here and argue that there's a lot of other Kiss tunes that I would want to be classics before
right.
Hell or Hallelujah ever would be one. That are classics to me that, listen, we talk about this all the time. We laugh about it. Crazy Nights to me is the album that I do that all the time. Is that a classic album? No
is
way in hell. No way in hell is it a classic album.
And let's use Cheap Trick as an example, okay? Here's the Cheap Trick songs that I think are classics. Now, I'm going to tell you off the bat, these are not my favorites, okay? But obviously, I want you to want me. Dream Police, Surrender,
Flame.
Possibly Tonight It's You,
The Flame,
If You Want My Love, The Flame, and that's about it. Whereas those would be on the lower part of the scale for me. But here's the thing. Riot never transcended the metalheads or the people who love hard rock. Okay, so really,
I didn't say they did. All I'm saying is that it's almost like this tribe mentality that a lot of people who listen to a band like Raven, you know, they know mind over metal. Because again, it's what I think is really cool is when you listen to Ozzy's Boneyard. And for those of you who don't know, SiriusXM has a station, Ozzy's Boneyard. They play classic hard rock and metal. And what I think is cool are the bands that I was into when I was younger who didn't have huge hits. But the tribe, if you want, knew they play the songs that especially back in my tape trading days, and another band like Saxon, who didn't have big radio hits here, there was something that we all fell in love with. And I'll still hear Denim and Leather on Ozzy's Boneyard. And that's my point. Was it a single in England? Yes. Was it? It did nothing here. But for some crazy reason, when they play those songs by Diamond Head and like I said, Saxon, and they, people who were into that, and there was thousands and thousands of us, it resonates. They just don't play, you know, what, like Rock and Roll All Night, or, you know, they just don't play Living After Midnight.
But, you know, I don't think a Sirius XM radio show that's devoted to playing that, I don't want to, obscure isn't the right tune, but playing metal is exactly what I would use to define as those are classic. That might be a classic sound of that era, but it's not a classic band. It's not, you know, I don't want us to confuse classic as in meaning the classic sound of Kiss, the classic sound of an era, versus classic meaning it's transcended everything else, as Tommy said. It's going to stand the test of time, that when 30 years from now, when somebody still plays Kiss on the radio, are they going to play Hell or Hallelujah, or are they going to play Rock and Roll All Night?
That's obvious. It's almost like not even worth talking about. Of course they're going to play.
No, it is worth talking about, because Paul himself is sitting here saying he thinks Hell or Hallelujah will become classic. And my question is, how is it ever going to become classic? Nobody hears this song. Nobody's heard it. They don't play it. No radio plays it. It could be the greatest Kiss song. No denying that. It's going to get completely lost, and it will never move out of just being a great Kiss song in the Kiss Army world. It will never become the Kiss song that radio stations 30 years from now go to. Ooh, we've got a choice between playing Love Gun or Hell or Hallelujah. They're going to go, what is Hell or Hallelujah? I've never heard of this song.
And this is really going to hurt, Mark, okay? So be prepared, but I'm not being mean. All right? Okay?
It doesn't matter what.
Talk Dirty to Me by Poison.
Oh, boy, would you look at the time.
Is more of a classic song than any of the Raven songs you've mentioned, or Riot, or whomever. It's not better, but it's a classic.
Every rose has its thorn.
Yeah, everybody freaking knows the song. That's what, to me, the definition of classic is. Don't confuse classic with good.
Confuse popular with classic.
But it is. If you go to the masses and you ask them about these songs.
I don't care about the masses. I could care less. They mean nothing.
I know.
He's changing the rules again, Tommy.
God, help me. Someone help me. Michael, help me. I
totally get what Mark is saying.
I
totally get what Mark is saying.
But it's too totally.
And if you're a classic, this song should contain elements of what made the band classic. Hell or Hallelujah contains elements of the classic Kiss sound. Therefore,
that has nothing to do with being classic.
I just said it did, so it does.
But you're what you're describing is what makes up a great Kiss song to you. I would sit here and say, I want pop and I want keyboards in my great Kiss song.
I think if more people were exposed to it, maybe it would. Let's face it, the radio didn't play it. It wouldn't play it. You know what I mean? Come on, let's be for real. Look how great the new Cheap Trick album is. No one's playing it.
It's not, and it's right. You know what? Right.
I hate
and
to
it's
say
never,
it. None of those songs are going to be classics.
They're never
going to
be classics.
There's a few on that record that could very well be my favorite Cheap Trick songs
there,
of
there
all
are
time.
Song, if that album came out in 1979, that could have become classic songs. Because they came out in 2016, they're never going to become classics. Me as a Cheap Trick fan, that freaking sucks, and I hate that. But being just dealing with the reality of what we've got is a music industry now, it's never going to happen. It's just not going to. Hell or Hallelujah can never become a classic Kiss song outside of the hardcore Kiss fans, the 150,000 who bought it.
Well, look how they package some of these greatest hits records. They call them, you know, the classic stuff. Well, a great example of this, and Kiss is in a way too, but Rainbow is the greatest example of what's classic. Because to me, Kill the King, Man on the Silver Mountain, to most people, is going to be. So here you got a Ronnie James Dio is up here, one song. Because most masses only know Man on the Silver Mountain. Then you go to Graham Bonnet, Since You've Been Gone. But I think All Night Long is as good as that. But again, that era now is reduced down to one song. Then you got the Joel and Turner era. Stone Cold was a pretty big hit. Is Rainbow just reduced to three songs with three different singers? You're missing out on classic music if you
We're
do
not
that.
Arguing
We're
that.
Not
I'm
arguing,
not
arguing
that.
That
point. I agree with you 100%. What I'm saying is what people in general would consider to be a classic is stuff that they know. They don't like what they know. You know?
You guys, I guarantee.
They may not even know what they're missing.
You've all turned other people on to music before, haven't you? That friends have went, wow, thanks for the tip. That's good stuff. I guarantee each one of you has a friend. You've loaned a CD, a band they never heard of. And they fell in love with it.
Yes.
Because it's classic music. Doesn't matter.
But that's not what we're talking about, okay?
Classic music is not the same as a classic tune. A classic song. And the way I read Paul's comment is he's not talking about a classic sounding Kiss song. He's talking about a Kiss song that will stand the test of time, and 30 years from now when Kiss 3.0 is touring, he's claiming people are going to be going Hell or Hallelujah.
Yeah, they're going to leave the venue going, I can't believe they didn't play that song.
Let's be honest. We can say that now because we don't know.
Well, no, you're 100% right. We don't know, but I'm just going off of what does it take to get a song to that level? It takes exposure. And you're right. Kiss has never been a radio band, so the only other way to give songs exposure is Kiss themselves plays it. And if Kiss themselves don't even play the song, don't even keep pounding it in, how is it going to become a classic song? It doesn't just happen by itself.
Kiss is amazing to me, much like Iron Maiden is. You guys are both not Iron Maiden fans, or big Iron Maiden fans.
Small.
I'm not at all.
Tommy, name me an Iron Maiden song. I bet you can. I bet you can name at least two.
I can name Run for the Hills. And
the title track from that record.
I don't know the name of the record. I think that might be the only one I know. Because of the Cowboy and Indian video.
Yes. Well, Number of the Beast is a...
Okay.
I'm sure you're familiar with the 666 Number of the Beast song.
I would recognize the songs as soon as I hear them. I would have a hard time sitting here rattling off a bunch of Iron Maiden tunes, let alone telling you what album they came from.
Well, look, here's a great example of what I talked about the Ozzy's Bone. The Trooper is not a song that was played, you know, top 40 wise. But most people who like hard rock or metal know that, you know, the beginning of the song. It's iconic in many ways. And the word, you could also just say it's a classic metal song. Because blindly, if I played that song, you both would go, oh, that's Iron Maiden. You may not be a big fan of the song or the band, but you know it was Iron Maiden. That's kind of what I'm getting at. It doesn't have to be have tons of popularity. It doesn't have to be use that as the term classic. It's just got to be something you feel. And I go back to the this, especially back when I was younger, how all these bands, we bought their records and we traded their tapes, but we didn't hear them on the radio.
So back to Hell or Hallelujah, if you picked an average off-the-street music, even hard rock fan, and you just played Hell or Hallelujah, are they going to instantly know that that's Kiss? I would say no.
It hasn't had enough time to germinate. That's what Paul's saying.
But and I get that. It does take time. But part of what goes along with time is, think about it this way. You say to germinate. Well, what does it take to germinate? You've got to water it. You've got to expose it to sun. And you got to add. You can't just throw a seed in the grass and go, there you go. Grow on your own, little seed. You're on your own. If Hell or Hallelujah doesn't get a little radio airplay or a little bit of playing in concert or something else to go along with it, it's not going to germinate on its own. It's just not going to happen. Just because it's a good song doesn't mean it's going to sprout roots and grow. Right, something's got to help it.
Michael, the kids that go to the Kiss concerts now, let's face it, there's little kids there. Say they like Kiss and they end up 30 years ago from now, like me, they bought my collection because I'm not worm food.
Meatloaf.
They may have Monster and think those are class because it's 30 years from now. I don't know. I'm not there.
Well,
all I know is the elements that are there because that sound is a classic sound. That sound
not arguing the sound, but what's going to cause a bunch of people to all of a sudden buy Monster when we know, I don't know, what's Monster at now? 150,000, 250,000, maybe max worldwide have been sold. Beyond that small number of people, and that is a small number of people in our ever-exploding world population that people like to throw at us, a lot of...
What's the percentage?
A very small percent of people have been exposed to Hell or Hallelujah. And unless something comes along that causes Hell or Hallelujah as a single or the album to drive sales, it's just not going to happen on its own. That's all I'm saying is something's got to help push it along. And maybe that something will happen that we don't know about. But based on what we know right now, today, July 26th, there's nothing that's going to make Hell or Hallelujah a classic song. At least Paul, play it every night then. If you believe so much in that song, play it.
I want to go back to something that you just said, and it's true. I'm not arguing with you. How many that record has only sold, 150,000 copies, correct?
I have no idea.
We'll find out.
Guessing.
So I'll say
a fair estimate.
150,000-200,000 worldwide.
Correct. The song "Hell or Hallelujah," the lyric video. I'm looking at it right now on YouTube. Over 1 million hits, 1 million views, over 1 million. The world's different. You can't. This is what I'm talking about. That fucking shit that groupthink that people, 1 million people played this. I'm looking at it right now. Lyric video 1,300,521 on a record that sold 150,000.
But Mark, I mean,
a million people.
Yeah, but to argue
that's what Paul Stanley said. Hold on.
No, hold on. I'm gonna debunk that million. That's not 1 million people who sat down and listened to the whole song. That's 1 million people who had that video start playing and that maybe within 10 seconds hit the stop to go to the next one. And YouTube counted it as a play.
Well, that's like saying, look at me. I have how many different copies that I bought of all the Kiss catalog. It's like saying each one is an individual one.
Million people did not listen to Hell or Hallelujah on YouTube. That's not what 1 million means. It means, I think in YouTube's definition of a play, it ran for 10 seconds and then people left. Does that count?
I'm going to go a step further. There's more than one Heller Hallelujah. There's probably a dozen. Some of them are in the hundreds of thousands. That one happened to be over a million. So you can't just say what you hear on the radio, because that got a million.
If this is such a great classic song, why isn't Kiss playing it?
I don't know. Ask Paul Stanley. I'm not.
That's part of what I'm saying is, if it Lick It Up, they play Psycho Circus, they play, you know, all these other classic tunes, they play. When's the last time they played Heller Hallelujah?
Well, how was the last time they played Heaven's on Fire? You could argue that's a classic Kiss song.
They've played it a lot more than they've played Heller Hallelujah.
Michael, I'm not disagreeing with you. You're right.
I'm just saying that if Paul thinks this is going to become classic, what is going to help it become classic? We know it's not going to be radio airplay.
YouTube.
No, YouTube is not going to do it alone. No, sorry. A million views on YouTube is not going to make anything classic. Nothing. 100 million, different story. 1 million, not going to mean anything. And I'll even add to it that, and I'm not saying Kiss did this, but you could buy a million views tomorrow if you want your video to look good. So that's not concrete evidence.
This was 4 years. Got a million views in 4 years. What's it going to be in another 10 years? I don't know.
Well,
I'm not there.
I'll argue that a million views in 4 years is pretty piss poor, really.
250,000 a year. It's actually over that.
That's not a definition of classic.
You can't compare, like, I guess what I'm getting at, you boil it all down. You can't compare Hotel California to Heller Hallelujah. Two totally different things. But as a fan, as a music fan, I think it's a classic Kiss tune. I love it. And I think I love it because
not to talk about as a Kiss fan, I like the tune. It's as not being a diehard Kiss fan, three geeks who spend 2 hours every frickin' week dissecting this band. If it wasn't us, would anybody on the street, you go, hey, you've seen Kiss, and yeah, I saw Kiss once, you know, 5-6 years ago, Heller Hallelujah, classic tune. I could guarantee you that the vast majority of them, probably 99%, would go, I've never heard that song.
Yeah, and you could use Shock Me as the oddball. It didn't get any airplay, but because it was tied to Ace Frehley and the smoking guitar, that one would probably stick in some people's minds as a classic that would transcend the traditional Kiss audience.
They played it so much in concert.
Yeah, I'm not arguing, Mark, that you're wrong with.
Wouldn't know most of Kiss's. I'm talking the average.
Right.
Know most of their catalogs.
But
I thought we were, again, classic is so.
That's why the word is, we're using the wrong word for what you're describing. Because what you're talking about, I agree with your passion. I agree with everything you're saying. But that's not what I thought the topic was today. I thought the topic was what makes a classic song, meaning in the general public's eyes. And unfortunately, that's going to be Rock and Roll All Night, Beth, Shout It Out Loud, Love Gun, all of those, because everyone knows them. That's what makes it a classic. I'm not saying if it's good or bad or better than something else, or that, you know, Raven or whomever doesn't have classic songs or it's a classic sound. We're talking about acceptability by the general public, where any guy walking down the street, you could say, hey, dude, Kiss. And they'll be like, oh, yeah, Rock and Roll All Night. So they have a very limited amount of what I would consider to be classic songs in the general population viewpoint. Doesn't make it good or bad, but that's why the Rolling Stones and the Eagles and a lot of those types of bands have more, simply because the exposure was there. And so the argument is how, as a younger band, do you ever create a classic song now at this point? I can tell you that 6 AM, I would say, are on the verge of a classic song with Life Is Beautiful, which is off of their first the first record, because enough people have heard it now. I could almost throw it in the classic category, because you have a whole crap load of people at a festival, which I saw this on Saturday with my own eyes, singing every word to that song. And you got to tell me there was more than just 6 a.m. fans there. So it's like, it's that familiarity. Bad Company would be another perfect example of a band that has a lot of classic songs. You know, John Mellencamp, Tom Petty, because it's just one right after the other. You could take anybody with you.
To your point, Tom, you bring up a great point. You know, we all know Gene had that article and that quote of rock is dead. There's never going to be another great rock band. I think maybe after hearing this, the more accurate statement is rock isn't dead, but the classic tune, the classic song is dead. It's virtually impossible for any band today, as you just said, Tommy, to create a classic mm-hmm. song. There's no means or mechanism to create a classic song anymore that will live for 40 years from now. Rock is not dead. The ability for a great song to be created that is the, you know, when you're talking Eagles, I actually think of Desperado, because it's like there was a whole Seinfeld episode about Desperado. Shh, Desperado's on. It's my song. Okay, you know, that's never, I should say never, but it's almost unlikely a song will ever transcend and become something like that, whether it's, oh my God, Beth is on. Shut up. You know, I got to hear this.
And the ones that continue to live, so the younger kids know about Stairway to Heaven. They know about certain Beatles songs, Live and Let Die, Paul McCartney, or, you know, Get Back and Let It Be. There's just, to me, those are the classic songs, right or wrong. That's what everybody knows. And that's all I was saying, not to your point, Mark. If you said to me, what's a classic Kiss song, my favorite classic Kiss songs in your definition, it'd be a whole different list, and it would be starting with Flaming Youth. But I bet you couldn't find one person who's not a Kiss fan that would know that song, but everyone freaking knows Shout It Out Loud.
I get all that, but my definition of classic is different.
Right, but that's why we need to use a different... But that's why we should be using a different word for the discussion that you're trying to have, because I think that what you're saying is a very valid point. But to me, I would use a different word to keep from getting confused. So if you don't want to use the word classic for what I was trying to say with Michael, so then choose a different name.
How about for what Tommy, what you and I are talking about, timeless, and what Mark is talking about, classic sound.
Fine. Okay, so then what timeless songs does Kiss have? I would say to you again, Detroit Rock City, Shout It Out Loud, Beth, maybe Dr. Love, because a lot of people seem to know that. Rock and Roll All Night.
On the charts. That was one of their highest charting singles.
Yeah. Lick It Up. Rock and Roll All Night. It was made for loving you. Lick It Up.
Forever.
Heaven's on Fire. Forever. And that's, and maybe Hide Your Heart, but that's a, well, no, I would say Domino.
No, I wouldn't even go there.
I don't think anybody.
But that's about
it. Again, to me, that's a classic song. I love that song. And it hits the word classic all the way around with me. But I don't think most people know that song.
Well, it's got a shitload of airplay here, and everyone seems to love that song because about the part about the girl bending over. But needless to say, that's about it, I think, for Kiss, more than anything else. You could maybe throw Cold Gin in there and a few others, but that's about it. You know, whereas, you know, the Beatles, I could name 30 or 40. You know, it doesn't make it any better or any different or lessens Kiss's impact for people who love them and love their music.
Kiss in general almost is like what I was talking about, my groupthink mentality, because we all, you guys in Minnesota and me here in Detroit, we didn't know each other when we were kids, but we bought the records and we loved the music. And that's to me what makes it classic, and it makes it timeless. We loved the album cuts as much as we loved, you know, the other songs. It I don't know, man. It just, I still go back to, you know, what I've said 3 or 4 times here. I just find it amazing that certain bands that never got airplay, fans around the world, and Iron Maiden's probably the greatest example of this, know the songs. They bought into it. They made it classic. They made it timeless. And no one, and they didn't get any help from radio. Right. There's something deeper. And that's kind of where I'm going. There's something deeper in the word classic and timeless. That's how come Iron Maiden can go to South America. They go to countries where it's not even the native language, and people are singing along. It's classic. It's timeless. It means something.
So can we use the word popular?
Well, yeah, but I think popular to me is – again, guys, this is no offense. Popular to me is a who cares, because, you know, Milli Vanilli was popular.
I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'm not saying
it's right or wrong either, but, I mean, popular to me is it's not fun. Popular to me means nothing.
But, you know, we could almost –
there's no passion in popular.
Do I have any fucking Advil in here?
We could almost have two classifications of a timeless song. Timeless within...
Eastern Red.
A timeless song within the artist's own fan base, and a timeless song that extends outside of the artist's fan base.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, I mean, your Iron Maiden, there's timeless Iron Maiden songs that Iron Maiden fans are going to recognize, but that same timeless song is not going to be recognized by Tommy.
I couldn't tell you the first thing about it, whereas I can tell you about certain songs of bands
Tommy,
that don't particularly...
Does Garbage have any classics on?
No.
Okay.
No, they don't, yet I love almost their entire catalog, but I can't think. I would say actually maybe one, like Stupid Girl or Queer off the first record had enough radio airplay that most people would be familiar with one of those two, but it's fringe at the very best, which also talks to the way everything has changed. So even though people continue to make new music, a lot of it will never be heard. That's why I was saying earlier with AC/DC, I know that train song that they do, whatever, Rock and Roll Train,
yeah,
because it was that. Just beaten into the public on the FM radio, so that my brother-in-law, Jerry, who is a construction worker, would go, oh, yeah, I know that song. That's AC/DC.
But here's a great – when they made that record, they tried to make a classic-sounding AC/DC song. They used the elements that made it sound classic, and that's one of the reasons that it became – I don't think most people – put it this way. This is a good example. I don't think most people would pick that as a classic AC/DC song if you had to tell people, can you name 10 AC/DC songs? But it sounds like classic AC/DC.
But it's more of a fringe – right. But it's more of a fringe song.
In both examples, though. Really? I mean, to be
fair.
Yeah,
but the last Rolling Stones record that came out, I couldn't name one single song off of there that is a classic, yet I'm sure it's a good record. I heard several songs off of it, and I liked it. The point being is that I think to get it to the classic status, you need MTV, FM radio, maybe now YouTube, or the platforms are changing to...
It doesn't exist, and it hasn't existed forever.
Right, so to push it past to soak into the conscience of somebody. So I would say to you that another element that we haven't discussed that would push things to a classic level would be a lot of those songs now that are in the video games that my kids play. And they're like, oh, yeah, I know Radar Love. Well, Radar Love is a classic song. I would use that as an example of a classic song because freaking everybody who's listening to FM radio knows the Golden Earring song, Radar Love. Well, now my daughter knows it because it's in one of those, you know, video games that she plays.
My daughter, one time I was cranking some Lynyrd Skynyrd, and she goes, oh, I know this song. It was funny because we're talking about Adam Sandler earlier. What's the golf one? Happy Gilmore.
Yeah.
They played Tuesday's Gone there towards the end, and my daughter's like, hey, I know the song. And I'm like, you don't listen to Lynyrd Skynyrd. She goes, oh, no, it's in the golf
Happy
movie.
Like, oh, exactly. Because it transcends their consciousness, so they hear it.
If Hell or Hallelujah ends up in a big hit movie, it could
become
classic.
And we don't know yet.
We don't. Right. But I'm just saying, at this moment, as I said, at this moment, based on what we
That's
do
a betting
know,
man.
I would not bet on Hell or Hallelujah becoming classic because
but
nothing is happening.
It first has to sound like classic, whatever it is.
No, it doesn't. Does
yes,
Beth?
It does.
No, it doesn't. Does Beth sound like classic Kiss?
It does not.
There we go. Thank you. It's a classic
but
tune.
It's a classic song, but let's face it, too. There's again, what did I say earlier? In order to do this, there's got to be some bit of hypocrisy in it because it's just talking about music. People associate Kiss with Beth, but it was such an anomaly. You know what I mean? It really was an anomaly. And
Tommy, is the Flame sound like Jeep Trick? I would say
yes.
No.
I think it does. I'm with Tommy. I think it does.
I think it does
sound
because
like
I can't.
Classic Cheap Trick. It's not the classic Cheap Trick sound that I hear. It's the 80s. Let's make a hit sound that everybody was doing.
But for me, it's unique in the respect, Michael, that I can't. It's Robin Zander's vocals are just so.
Well, sure.
Can't the
vocals are unique. I'll give you that. But it's not a classic sounding Cheap Trick song to me. Yet it became a huge, huge hit for them.
Right. Right.
Dream Police is a classic Cheap Trick sound.
Yeah.
It's funny, though, too, because, back then, I was just happy to hear Cheap Trick on the radio again. And obviously, we're all Cheap Trick huge fans. I didn't know that was a cover when I first heard it because it sounded like them. You know what I mean?
Right.
And I'll give you an example. At that time, when the new Heart stuff was coming out, because I was such a big Heart fan, that didn't sound like Heart. You know what I mean? It didn't have that classic 70s element to it. When I'm trying to think of some, because I don't like the music at all. What were some of the big Heart? Alone stuff, I guess.
Alone.
Alone song to me sounds like Heart, but some of the songs that they were doing at that, and they're off the Bad Animals album. I just didn't do it for me because I liked Keep Your Love Alive. I like the almost Zeppelin-esque, how Heart sounded, and they didn't sound Zeppelin-esque anymore.
And you know what?
I agree with that, those songs, believe it or not, are probably some of the most classic songs that Heart did in the 80s because they reached that mass over and above even the FM Heart that I love, like Magic Man and Even It Up and all of that.
And as you so you love know. To say, Mark, timeline is important. What if you are first introduced to Heart with those albums and that's what blows you over? That's the Heart sound.
Michael, you're 100% correct. Yeah, timeline is everything there. But for my ears, it turned me off. Whereas the Cheap Trick one didn't, because it sounded like Cheap Trick to me. It sounded like it could be Voices or something. You know what I mean? It was mellow, but it was like, it sounds like a song they would have written to me.
But at the same time, I'm not saying that your ears are wrong in any way, shape, or form. I'm simply saying the classic definition to me is what everyone knows. It's not right or wrong. And unfortunately, lots of times I feel like the songs that become the most popular that we consider classics make absolutely no sense to me. So let's take a look at Crazy Nights, one of his favorite Kiss albums. Crazy Nights, I think, is an awful song because I hate the same repetitive nonsense of that song. However, I would say to you that I'll Fight Hell to Hold You is probably the best song on the record. I would maybe even put it in my top 10 or 20 Kiss songs of all time. Why wasn't that the first single? Because
I like that song too.
Yeah, you know what I mean? It's not that I don't feel like, you know, I'll Fight Hell to Hold You is not a classic Kiss song, but you say that to somebody and they're like, huh? But if you say Crazy, Crazy Nights to someone or Heaven's on Fire, more often than not, the casual rock fan knows those songs. Unfortunately, that's how it goes. You always wonder, why did you release this particular song as the first single? You know, and it is all about payola and radio push. I'm not denying for one moment that there isn't a lot of corruption there to get certain songs lift off. But it is what it is, because I can't even imagine how many incredibly wonderful songs that I've never heard by a plethora of talented artists simply because I've never been exposed to them.
This is really super deep, and this has nothing to do with Kiss, but when people say, like, this was the greatest song ever, this is super deep, but think this is something just to think about. How many songs have been recorded in human history? Like billions, maybe?
Well, let's just use this as an example. Spotify has a catalog of 30 million songs.
Okay. So of the songs that were recorded, just recorded, how many made the radio?
40. And if you want, it's called top 40.
Yeah. Well, then go one deeper. How many songs were ever written? I mean, it's in the trillions. My point is this. The most greatest song in the world, the song that was mathematically no one's ever heard, because it probably, A, wasn't recorded, and B, never made the radio. If you want to look at songs that were ever written, ever, a small fraction of them were recorded, and an even smaller fraction made the radio. You follow along?
No, I do. And to your point, I tell a number of my young and indie clients, a great song that's never heard is not a great song. That's why you need to have marketing. If nobody ever hears your song, it's not a great song. But somebody can take the crappiest song, and I use this as the example. Remember, I don't remember what her name was. She had that YouTube hit called Friday. It was a stupid, it was stupid, terrible song. She doesn't even like music, but she recorded this one-off song called Friday, and it blew up. Tens, hundreds of millions of YouTube plays, tons of marketing behind it. It became a great song to so many people. Why? Because they heard it. But
Gangnam Style is another perfect example.
Exactly. But you can write and record the greatest song in the world, and if you don't put it out and you don't push it and you don't get the right promotion behind it and nobody ever hears it, it will never be a great song. It'll be great to you. You heard it. You recorded it. Your mom loves it. Your girlfriend loves it. But that's nothing. So, I mean, yeah, Mark, you're totally right on the mark. There's so many great songs that we've never heard. But they don't exist because we've never heard them.
Well, that's one of the things, you know, go back to just being a music fan. I like when I hear other people talk about bands, and that's when I go to record shows, and even older bands, I'll try and buy, for $3 on a used vinyl. I can't tell you how many times I got lucky and went, wow, I found this band that I heard, maybe Mick Ralphs from, whatever, Mötley Hoople or Bad Company talk about, or a guitar player. That's how I got into the blues stuff, because I kept reading how much Jeff Beck and Jimmy Page loved all these guys from the 50s. It's like, wow, and that's just the fun part about it. And I tell you what, having these kind of spirited discussions, just rules. I this is why we do the show. It's a lot of fun.
But and back to the very original point, you will not have a timeless song if it's never heard. You can't. You cannot have a timeless song if it's never heard by people. It can be on the album that was released, but if it's just never played, never heard, never watched, never, it will never become timeless. Something's got to happen to help propel that song to become timeless. As your example, maybe it shows up in a movie soundtrack. Well, it's going to take something like that to happen.
Well, and back to Mark's point from many times before he said it, is that anyone who says they're not a Kiss fan have never listened to Kiss. I agree with that wholeheartedly, but unfortunately, it's like anything else. Some things in life are just unfair, and the way they were treated critically and by the radio stations hurt them more than they helped them. Yes, it helped to create it from the ground up, and they made something that was truly against the odds. But at the same time, I could argue that there's at least a couple dozen more songs in their catalog that should be considered classics by the general public, but will never get there because it just didn't take off
the way it
should have.
I want to take you back to the summer of 1980, where this band called AC/DC was finally blowing up. And say we would have had us three back in 1977, could have looked back and we could have argued that Dirty Deeds Done Dirt Cheap, which I think you guys would say is a classic song.
It's a timeless AC/DC song.
And it was recorded in, what, 76?
But it was reissued, and then the radio took a hold of it after the
point. I'm wrapping all of our points into it. In 1977, I could have been here going, look, it sounds like classic AC/DC. This is what this band sounds like. But what happened? The band gets big. Somebody in America in 1981 is smart enough to go back and go, hey, I think this would sell. And next thing you know, it's blown up. I mean, like Michael said, people played it. But to me, in my heart, the classic was always there. It's just that everyone else caught up to it because they got to hear it. It was classic to begin with because it had all the classic elements of what makes AC/DC great.
It was a classic sound to begin with. It became a timeless song because something else propelled it.
And what propelled it was Highway to Hell, and it got reissued, and that's what did it. Had they not reissued that record between Highway to Hell and Back in Black, it may never have become a timeless song because it wouldn't have gotten the propel.
Believe, because I'm a geeky AC/DC fan too. I think the band was pissed because it was issued. I could be wrong, but I'll check. That was issued after Back in Black.
Oh, it could be. I don't know my AC/DC timeline.
And I remember reading because I was such a voracious reader about that stuff, the band being so pissed because they were just about to put For Those About to Rock out. And they're like, hey, what are you doing? We're now this is the version of AC/DC that we're trying to sell, and you're putting Bon out. Don't get me wrong, it's great, and I'm glad they did and everything, but if you're Brian Johnson, and you're like, hey, look what we just did, and what's the next thing the record company does? Boom. And then what did they do after that? They put Jailbreak out as well, trying to, mine that gold a little bit more, mm-hmm. And it really bothered the band that they did that, although it was very successful and made them a lot of money.
Right.
But my point is, goes back to Hell or Hallelujah. It's got a sound classic first before anything else. And that's where I'm going to leave it.
But we've already disputed that because Beth doesn't sound like classic Kiss.
Fair enough. In the world, there are anomalies. That's why
your example is great, but your example of AC/DC is 40 years ago. That is not going to happen with Hell or Hallelujah and Kiss.
It just isn't.
The whole industry that existed back then is completely gone. Kiss is not a band that's about ready to break. Kiss is a band that has already broke, is in the twilight years. An album is not going to get reissued.
1978, you could have had the same argument about Dirty Deeds. You could have the same one.
No, it's not the same argument. It's not the same argument, though, because back then, there was a music industry that was releasing music, that was developing music. There is no music industry right now. Kiss sold 150,000 copies worldwide of the Monster album. There's no public out there buying music anymore. There's nobody knocking on Kiss's door going, we need to reissue this and redo this and give you another shot at it. That's not happening. And to my other earlier point, that's not happening for everybody now. That's why I don't know if we're going to have timeless songs ever again, because that type of machine to create timeless songs, to beat a song to death into our heads, doesn't exist anymore. To the point where, you know, you remember during the 80s, we'd be like, oh, God, if I have to hear that song one more frickin' time, I'm going to kill myself. Nobody says that anymore because you don't hear the songs, period. There's just no mechanism out there. And that is my main point about this. Could Hell or Hallelujah become classic? Sure, it could. But there's no machine out there to make it happen anymore. There's just no machine.
That's the problem with the labels being gone. So that's the sad piece, is that it's really tough. So that's why I used Solid Ground for Tom Kiefer. It still wouldn't be considered a classic at this point off his new record, but he religiously plays that song every single time without fail. And at this point, that may be the only way to propel it, and that's even a long shot, I think, because of how it's changed.
I think Tom Kiefer's even in a worse situation than Kiss, because people are being like, Tom Kiefer? Who?
Kiefer, who's that? What? Yeah, what? They don't even know who he is.
Kiefer, is that something my wife does?
Oh, that's funny. Honey, I don't like when you're Kiefering.
Not an insult to you, Tom. It's just, I don't know. All right. Yeah. So let's leave it at that. Mark was wrong.
Yeah, pretty much.
I'm right as always.
Mark sent us a message that dinner's getting cold, so we need to do not Spencer's crap. Right.
You know what? As I told Mike and Tommy today, in the spirit, how I say it doesn't have to be old to be classic. Here's something that's not old. It's the Japanese version of Kissology. This thing, and I think you can still get it on. This thing is super cool. This is the box it came in. I'm going to open it because there's so many cool things in here.
It's no longer a classic if it's been opened.
But he's already opened it. I still want him to mail something with the Kiss stamps.
That's not happening.
That's not happening.
What, Tommy, what if you gave Mark $100? Would he then mail you the stamp?
No.
It's only worth what someone's willing to pay for it.
If Tommy was willing to pay $200, would you mail a stamp?
Look, my hamburgers are ready. You guys keep running your mouths, and this stays inside plastic. Okay.
He's getting all threatening.
If the sticker gets ruined, it's on you there, Summers.
Oh, my God. I won't sleep tonight. Mark wrecked a sticker. I'm going to have to go to therapy.
Well, I mean, how effing cool is this, really? I mean.
Well, so far, it's just a black box with a Kiss logo on it. So.
Come on. You need to go a little farther to impress us here.
Now, hold on. Opens up.
Do you notice you can see the porn in the background on this on the screen because the front of the box is so shiny? See, he's looking at porn.
I'm trying to open this up, so I'm gonna take some of the stuff out here. It's got all the Kissology booklets.
www.squirters.
Swingers.com.
Florida Swingers. Wow, we were right.
Oh,
straight hell!
If you were there, he'd throw a hamburger at you right now, Tommy.
I'm gonna stop. Look, I'm gonna stop. You guys gotta be rude. They have reproduction picks exactly the way they were in '76.
Nice.
Excuse me, '77. Oh, those technically '76 too.
Peter had a pick.
No, seriously, Mark, did Peter Chris have a real guitar pick back then?
You know what? I don't think he did. If anybody wants to be as geeky as me, I don't believe he did. But these are cool. Like I said, the best part is how, if you guys know your guitar picks, that's the way Gene's was. Like yes. Everybody else had their name.
Mm-hmm.
And then it, as you know, a reprint on a button. Like I said, this is the coolest thing for, about this. I'm going to be getting to in a second. I thought this was kind of cheesy, but cool. And your own mirror ball comes in this box set too.
I'm not going to say anything. I could have a comment about the mirror ball, but we don't want to piss Mark off.
Totally. It's almost like he's opening up a magic box.
All right, here we go. This is the cool stuff.
Watch me unlink these through hoops.
It pulls into a stage.
For the McFarlane figures, so you can take photos or a book?
No, it does not. This kind of bummed me out because they did a reprint of the ticket. But they put Psycho Circus things on it. Don't ruin it.
It was a classic ticket, but it isn't anymore.
Isn't anymore. Hold on here. But the best part, the absolute best part, and this is because obviously I didn't cut all mine out because I'm just not that guy. But this is, they have the like little, this is, they tell you how to do it. Put the little figures on stage. All right, now I'm getting to the part that I like best. If I can do this without knocking it over. Again, if I get knocked over, Tommy's buying me a new one. Right, Tommy? The things I do for this show.
That's really rich coming from a guy who encouraged me to take some Advil just to get through this.
Hold on.
To say that you'll get nothing and like it.
That's right, Spalding. You'll get nothing in life.
I want a hamburger and a cheeseburger and a diet soda.
Oh, hold on here. Oh, man. I don't want to rip nothing. I'm doing this. All right, here we go. Here comes the cool part. Of course, unopened. Sealed t-shirt, and no, I'm not opening this.
You're not going to put it on?
No. But here's the coolest part. For those in the know, well, I'm going to get to the second coolest part. I told you about the little figures you can. This is the little figures. This is what goes on the stage. Again, holy shit! I want to take it out, but I don't want to rip it. All right. Ooh. Oh, my God. I can't believe I'm doing this.
But see, people love this because a lot of them don't have this.
Totally cool.
Look at how he's very careful not to even put fingerprints on it.
Oh.
I'm surprised he doesn't have gloves.
Kiss mittens while he's opening it up.
It's almost like he's like working on the Declaration of Independence.
Yeah. All right, hold on. You know, I'm getting to the best part. This is really the reason to buy this. Not many people know. This came with a tour book. A tour book that was never been released before. You can only get this tour book in this box. And the photos are fucking amazing.
Photos you've never seen before?
You know, for the most part, you know, they all kind of bleed into one. But I mean, just shots like this.
All right. Is this a legitimate tour book that was produced but never released back in the 70s?
No, it's legitimate. This tour book was only made for this. It's an official tour book because it's from an official KISS product. And not many people know that this tour book came in this Japanese only release.
So these are still available. How much are they selling for?
I mean, it's got it's very similar to the one that they released at the show.
Right.
I mean, none of the same pictures or anything, but I mean,
this is not a real tour book from the 70s. This is a book a fake book they made to put into this box set.
Well, no, it's not a fake book. It would it's a book they made to put in this box set to kind of capture, you know, Kiss in Japan.
Yeah,
and a lot of the
yes,
same
but
way.
I guess what I'm it's not a legitimate tour book from the 70s that they reprinted or that they never printed back then but finally did now. This was something that was made for the first time for this.
Correct. And you know what? I really should ask Alan to do this. Look at all the text in this. There's probably a treasure trove of things in here. Again, it's all in Japanese. But
for all you know, it just might be a whole bunch of meatloaf recipes over and over.
But the really super cool thing about this is that in look and in feel, it's just like something you get from the 70s. The pages
right.
have that same feel. And it's funny, though, too. You know.
But all kidding aside, though. Yeah, but all kidding aside, you said that these are still available. So you can find them maybe on Amazon or eBay or something like that.
Yeah, you can get this on eBay.
Okay, so what can someone plan on spending for what you're seeing out there right now?
Yeah, I haven't looked because I own one. But I know I'm pretty sure anywhere from 400 to 1,000. I can do a quick check. This is kind of cool because this is what I love about stuff like this. Now, Kiss never miss an advertising chance, right?
Right.
This is the only ad I know for this CD. Is in this store.
So,
just as a Kiss collector, just having an ad that, you know, it even tells the price of the CD.
Yeah,
how many Kiss fans, honestly, how many Kiss fans have even seen an ad for this CD?
But that CD, correct me if I'm wrong, but that CD was released separately only in Japan.
Correct.
Yeah, so it would make sense that there's an ad in a Japanese product to advertise a CD that was only released in Japan.
But that's what makes the ad, because I'm a geeky collector, like I was showing you guys earlier, you know, stuff like this from Holland. That's the stuff I like collecting, because it's not stuff you walked into Walmart and it was available for 3 months, you know. The only way to see that ad is to own the box. I'm cool with that.
Or
I love
watch
that.
Our show.
So that's again for the DVDs, or what is that?
Oh yeah, this is the Japanese Kissology, and what they did.
Is it just number one, or all of them?
All of them.
Okay.
This is the very last one.
Okay.
But when you stand it up on the stage, it's a set of speakers. You know what I mean? It's part of the. This thing is just so well made, and just so cool to have. Again, here's the second one.
Okay.
But it's a set of speakers, and when you open it up, it also has all the bonus discs already in there. You know what
so
I mean?
So every single bonus disc, so you wouldn't have. So like, if there was three different bonus discs, one at Walmart, one at Kmart, and one at Best Buy, are all of those in?
Yeah, all those are in here.
Okay, so then. How many of these were made? Do you know?
I don't know.
Okay.
I really don't. And here's here's the very first one. You know? So. And see,
see how it's scratched the DVD.
See how it says bonus disc?
Yeah.
Yeah. So to me, it's just a cool. You know what? Someone spent a lot of time on this. Someone put a lot of passion into it, and that's what I'm all about, man. If I'm gonna lay down, because I paid a lot of money, I can't remember. I think this thing was $600 or $700 when I bought it. But I saw in it what I'm always talking about. It's all about the music. It's music related. It's not silly. And that tour book for me, because I'm a crazy guy about stuff like that. You know, it's an official tour book, part of the official Japanese release with an official ad in there. It's got all new text, pictures that, you know, I'm not used to seeing. Like I said, if you got want to get a really cool, unique Kiss collectible, which ties in with what I say, it doesn't have to be old to be classic. This, to me, is about as classic a Kiss collectible as you can have, and it came out in the 2000s.
You say it doesn't have to be popular to be a classic.
Doesn't. Doesn't. What makes this classic to me is the passion put into it, and I love it. And I wanted to share it with everybody, and I was kind of waiting for the right time. This is the right time.
I would agree with you. That was a very cool collectible. Thank you for sharing that, because I never even heard of it.
You know what? I'm online here. I can see if I can find it.
Why don't you? Just out of curiosity, because I would love to know if they're available, how much they are, to let people know. Because I'd be willing to bet you there's at least one person who watches this show who, once they see that, they're going to be like, oh, my God, I got to have that.
Yeah, let me run this in here. Japanese Kissology. See where we go.
Let's all just sit back and watch Mark use a computer.
Well, he's got to minimize the swinger window.
Holy shit, look at this. Oh, it's not, it doesn't have
Did you find a couple right down the street?
They're going to be in Florida at the same time.
You guys. Oh, man. Look, I got dinner ready. I'm listening to you two knuckleheads.
Oh, God, we really got to do this live, all three of us in a bar. We
Couples
really...
and single gals, welcome.
They're called unicorns.
See? There you go.
Oh, my God, this is too much fun.
This does have the tour. It doesn't have the... it does. It's complete. 279 euros, which is just over $300.
Oh,
okay,
cheap.
so very reasonable. You that can still pick one up.
I paid more than that for mine, brand new.
Right.
You know what though? It's kind of like.
Are you on eBay or are you on Amazon?
I'm on eBay.
Okay.
I don't. You know. I guess you could check. The other one too. There's no bids on it. 3 days left. You want to get one? I think this one, it's used. It looks really good, though. You know, I'm looking at it.
Is it Elite Auctions?
No.
Well, in all fairness, too, isn't it worth pointing out to people that if they're going to buy something with this much detail and this much stuff in it, you should also look for the original ad for it or something to verify.
All right, here we go. The seam is split. It's not, man. They got a picture of a big seam split on the t-shirt. It looks like everything's there. There's a big split in the seam, though, on the box. Like, mine looks like the day it came out of the showroom. It's perfect.
Of course.
Yeah, there's a big rip on the seam. But still, I mean, for that price, you can't beat it. That's another thing, too. I mean, just as a collector, I mean, look, people you talk about stuff like Kiss lunchboxes and stuff. Like, oh, I got one. So if you sold yours for 100, mine's 100. I'm like, well, yours has got rust and it's beat to shit. I mean, it's cool you have one, but they're not the same when it's not mint, you know. Look, there's too many crazy collectors. It's funny, too. I was talking to a friend of mine. People invite me to these sites. Next thing you know, I'm on these sites. And I the stupidest things. I got to share with one right before we go. Some guy recently bought a fucking poster off of eBay. And it was obviously fan-made. And the pictures, like, it had, like, the first album picture, but it was, like the one that poster that Joe Marshall made. You know, it was, like, that picture. It wasn't the actual first Kiss album. And then the guy's like, hey, everybody, check out my new promo poster. And I'm like, and I just wrote him. I'm like, you know, dude, it's cool that you bought a fan-made art, but don't come on this poster collector site and say, look at my promo poster. And then I had people going, oh, then they're scrambling because they don't know anything they're fucking talking about, going, well, where'd you get it? And how much? And they're going, oh, my God, I've never seen that. And I'm like, oh, are you that fucking dumb? And then, like, a week earlier on this same fucking site, this guy's like, oh, my God, this guy's got two of these posters left, and they're promos from 78. And I'm like, there's a picture of Gene from 96 on that. Maybe that would give it away that it wasn't from fucking 78, you fucking dummy. And these are people that are like, oh, I know so much. Really? Really? It's a 1978. It was another. It was a 1978 poster, but it had Dynasty Live shots on it. And people are going back and forth about, you know, the age of the poster. I'm like, oh, this is supposed to be a collector site? The first thing, like I said, the very first thing, because it was a collage on it, the first thing I saw was that it was one of those things I was scrolling through on my Kindle. And I saw the picture of Gene from 96 on it. And I didn't pay much attention, but then I was going back and people added my name to it. And I'm like, and there's people arguing over it's either 78 or 79. I'm like, oh boy.
It's 2016 is when it was produced.
Yeah, exactly. And guess what, guys? The guy made it on his fucking home computer. Don't get me wrong. Look, if you want to love fan-made art, sweet. Fantastic. Love it. But don't come on a site that's for collectors and start telling people these things are what they're not. If that's what you wish it to be, it doesn't make it so.
Right.
That's all. And look, and then it's some guys like, well, how do you know all these promos there? How do you know this didn't come on? I'm like, you know what? I don't. But you know what I do know? I do know that that's a picture of Gene from 1996. That right. I do know. So, look, I'm not smart enough to be the absolute authority that I know every single promotional thing, because I see stuff in 2016 that I've never seen before still. And that's right. The fun part about being a fan. But some things are so goddamn obvious, it's not funny. And to put yourself out like you're a fucking know-it-all or something when you fucking don't have a clue.
Well, I think but you have to remember one thing. I think there's some people out there that they so badly want to find something that no one else has seen before, because you yourself just said there's things you haven't seen, and they so badly want to believe that they found that needle in the haystack and they want to be recognized as being the one to find it, that they get so caught up in the moment that they don't actually step back and really take a good hard look at what it is.
Well, you know what, though? If that's your motivation, it kind of goes back to what I said at the beginning of the episode. I didn't set out to fucking do a podcast and get to do some of the cool things I did or have done. I just was a fan.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I wasn't trying to, for lack of a better word, trump anybody or be better than or be. We're all the same. Look, we've said this before. I know all three of us agree. The only way to be the biggest, best Kiss fan is to love their music. That's it. You don't need to buy shit. You don't have to buy anything.
Yeah, but
no one's a better fan than the next guy. And that's the problem I have with some of these self-appointed fucking gurus on some of these Kiss sites. They, for some reason, think they fucking are better than anybody.
To your point, you probably didn't see it. In our newest episode on Facebook, there was about our Fuck, Marry, Kill from last week. One guy posted, oh, those were all softballs that you threw up there to pick. And I go, you're kidding. No, because as the very first one, Kiss, Destroyer, Revenge, that was not a softball. The three of us each had to work very hard. He goes, well, you know, if it would be hard if you were an average Kiss fan, I guess. And I said, oh, so the three of us are just average Kiss fans. Thank you for passing your judgment on what is a Kiss fan.
We're three knuckleheads.
he's like, it was a no-brainer. I'd throw this album out. Well, okay, great. It's a no-brainer for you.
Yeah, but it's not a no-brainer for everybody.
Exactly.
Though I thought the ones you came up with were pretty freaking hard. In fact, they were hard enough that Mark changed the rules.
Mark cheated.
You just said hard Mark in the same. What are you trying to fire? Use a subliminal thing? What are you doing?
That's Mark's.
You're hoping.
That's Mark's. Tommy, that's Mark's username on the swinger site. hard Mark Michigan.
Oh, my God. All right, we got to go.
And Liz would be, it's Friday, bitches.
No, it's Monday moaning.
It's Monday morning.
Monday morning, and hard.
Oh, go
Mark,
have
Michigan.
Some hamburgers.
All right, we need some homework. Some homework. So, first homework question: whose definition of classic was right? Tommy and mine, or
I
Mark's?
Like that. Yeah.
What if both Tommy and Mike's swinger names?
Oh, divert all.
The listeners are already established.
Yeah. Divert it away from you all you want, Hard Mark.
Hard Mark. That's awesome, Hard Mark.
I now know what the pick is going to say for the Kiss Cruise.
Oh, no.
All right, so whose definition of classic was right? And do you think Hell or Hallelujah can become a timeless classic Kiss song? Not a classic sounding song. Will it become timeless? Can it become timeless?
Or is it already?
Well, it ain't already. That's for damn sure.
We'll see. All right, guys. Food's getting cold.
All right. So there's your homework. Three Sides of the Coin. You know where to go. Leave comments, homework, everything else. ThreeSidesOfTheCoin.com, Facebook, Spreaker, YouTube, everywhere else. We're out of here.
Take Three Sides of the Coin with you anywhere. Download your 5-star rated free smartphone app today and listen on your Android or Apple smartphone. Visit android.threesidesofthecoin.com or ios.threesidesofthecoin.com. Want to get your official Three Sides of the Coin logo and shocker tee? Now you can. We ship worldwide. Get yours online at shop.threesidesofthecoin.com.
For interviews and media inquiries, contact Izzy at izzypresleyproductions.com.
Download your free copy of the KISS School of Marketing.
11 Lessons I Learned Working with KISS.
The number one downloaded business book on Noise Trade. Go to books.noisetrade.com/Michael Brandvold.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
Love the show. Go to itunes.threesidesofthecoin.com and leave your review and rating of Three Sides of the Coin. Thanks.